Welcome to the Festival of Storytellers.
Can't tell you how excited I am to be on right now. It's been a couple of weeks of excitement, getting prepared, and I've done a lot of things in my life, but this has got to be close to the top.
Thank you, Reader's Magnet, and thank you, John, for putting this forth and taking the chance on us authors in presenting this out to the world.
I've enjoyed this immensely, Joanne.
Ellie, so have I. Thank you for who you are, and thank you, Reader's Magnet. You all are beautiful, and you've worked so very hard, and we are blessed.
We are.
I thank everybody that's involved with this process, because we know writers need readers and writers need publishers. We thank Reader's Magnet and everybody that's involved. I love Reader's Magnet. They say, we share your stories with the world.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Or good morning, wherever you're located. I am Quinton Crawford, the author of the book Knowledge for Tomorrow, Mucha de Sucha Visits the Peace People, and the one I'm speaking about today, The Global Situation. one of my promos of the book, and each one of those topics, climate change, the disastrous fires that have been going on around the world, both in the Southern Hemisphere and the Northern Hemisphere, the majority of the year 2020, last year. And some of the year before, some of other years, and as we expect any disastrous storms to come and fires due to climate change. One of the, I guess we can call them side effects of the changes that are occurring right now. And I'll go over a lot of that, plus how you and I can hinder some of the damages that are occurring to our planet right now. We have a question. Oh, it's not posted yet. Question coming up. I will first give you what is now called the Earth Pledge. And I have this posted on page 13 in this book, available on Reader's Magnet's bookstore, online bookstore, available to be ordered into and demanded to be on the shelves by you at Barnes & Noble bookstores, as well as many other independent bookstores across the U.S., Canada, U.K., and I think it's approximately 80 other countries around the world. So if you feel that this is something that's needed, feel free to request the book to be on the shelf at your local bookstore. Okay. The Earth Pledge. I'll read this to you. I pledge allegiance to the Earth and to all the life that it sustains. One planet in our care, irreplaceable, with sustenance and respect for all. I know every country, practically every country in the on our world has its own pledge of allegiance of some type, but I believe we should begin, at least begin, to consider ourselves as world citizens, not just citizens of this or that country. It is extremely important for us to work together, because our world is in trouble. We're in trouble. Our entire biosphere is in trouble. I'll explain a few little details about that as well, including the drop in oxygen all around our biosphere, the layer of this planet that we live on. We're destroying the oxygen-producing life forms, or leading to that, their destruction, or per se, there'll be forests, both the rainforests and the temperate forests are all being burned up and cut down by, guess what species? You. Let's see here. I have a statement here from, actually a question, from Fairgoer991. For more than a year that the world is experiencing, how in our simple ways can we contribute to bring back the beautiful world we all wanted to have, or we're all supposed to be born in, essentially? And the ways I put in this book, throughout the book, several organizations, because we cannot do it alone. We must do it by factor of organizations, whether you create one yourself or join one or many yourselves and help. There's only one organization or somewhat business that I have found that is directly helping in the challenge against climate change. And it is one that is something of a challenge to Google itself. It is called ECOSIA, E-C-O-S-I-A. And I mentioned that, actually it's a web browser. You use the web browser, either in your phone, in your laptop, which is what I'm using for here to broadcast to you. Desktop computer or whatever type of computer, or a mobile phone, iPhone. You load in the web browser Ecosia. You use that web browser. Every time you do a search, the advertisers pay that web browser for the use. And that money with the Ecosia is channeled directly to porn nations, or the stations in porn nations around the world, mainly throughout Africa and South America, Central America, so on, and in Asia, in the Oceanic nations, including, I believe, also in the Philippines, Malaysia, Borneo, and so on. The money is used to pay people to plant trees all around the world. And when you look onto that site, I'm sure you'll be surprised to see how many trees per second counted have been planted or are being planted around the world at this very moment. Various time zones. It's over a million. It's way over a million trees so far. Approaching a billion about now. So we're making progress. Those of us that are active and trying to fix the problems, we're making progress. So don't give up. Just got to keep on going, keep on moving. Basically nonstop. You can have a rest a little bit yourself, but others around the world are continuing on in their time zones. A long time ago, I joined another organization called the Earth Charter, which is essentially I tried to become an umbrella organization. I'm trying to find, here's the page, it's on page two. I'm sorry, this book that I've written is over 300 pages of information and help for us all. Another question from Kim. What trees are the easiest to plant? I wanted to help and make a difference. So the trees easiest to plant, well, it's probably best you make sure the tree that you're considering is native to the place where you live. Now, don't want to contribute to plants fighting each other and for space in the wrong places, there's been a lot of damage done by simply planting a tree or some other kind of plant, or transplanting some type of other type of life form, animal or even fungi, to another place where it's not native, and it ends up taking over the space of the native plants or animals in the particular region where those whatever people, such as yourself, may be living. Like, I don't know where you live, Kim, but and I don't really post that. It's not necessary to unleash your privacy. There are species of, let's say, for example, frogs. And many amphibians are in great danger right now, because, you know, we'll be I'll try to get into endangered species as well. This is a part of the book. I've got over 1,000 endangered species listed in within the book. Just give you information of what is going on and where things are going on, both for the adults that may purchase the book and for any youth. Hopefully youth will also get this book, as well as any of my other books, is eligible to be within UNESCO. Each of my books are. Now, this is the actual book. This is the paperback version. I have an ebook and a hardcover of this book, as well as my children's book, Mucha the Suchi. This is the Peace People. Each of the books are available widely, Amazon, Barnes & Noble, practically any bookstore that has access to, a book, to be able to order books, whether it be online or direct. So there, it's available. Back to the Earth Charter. I'm sorry, I kind of went off track there. There's so much information to let you know, but I'm sure you can find it yourself. The Earth Charter has a preamble that really attracted my attention. We stand at a critical moment in Earth's history, a time when humanity must choose its future. As the world becomes increasingly interdependent and fragile, the future at once holds great peril and great promise. To move forward, we must recognize that in the midst of a magnificent diversity of cultures and life forms, we are one human family and one Earth community with a common destiny. We must join together to bring forth a sustainable global society founded on respect for nature, universal human rights, economic justice, and a culture of peace. Okay, Fairgoer 991, you have a question here. What inspired you in writing such a great book about current events and world issues? World issue, okay. I've had a genuine and somewhat natural interest and passion for other life on this that's around us. As a young boy, I used to be like many of the boys, and when they're 6-7 years old or so, run around places, look for nice looking rocks and what's under the rocks, and see great, wonderful life, different types, whether it be reptiles, some type of lizard, snakes, insects, spiders, and just looking at just the one interesting thing of that, how they move. They move very different than I do. And they move different than I do. Of course, as I'm a human, we use two legs and two arms. Some other life forms have many more limbs than, had many more limbs than I did. And some had no limbs, like snakes. I was interested in those. And I never liked to kill things just randomly. Some other boys and girls, interestingly, prefer to smash other things. And I didn't like that. And couldn't plants, just stepping on plants. And I cared for things. I wanted to grow my own garden. I believe I did when I was younger. I had to ask my parents. They remember better than I do. It's my mother. My dad has already passed. And also travel. My father was in the Air Force, U.S. Air Force. Traveled different countries when I was younger. My plane, and I enjoyed that. And giving up in the air like birds, it kind of fascinated me. So simple motion and observation kind of were the main inspirations for me, including as well as my great grandmother, which told me a lot of stories about life on her land when she was here. I won't go too much into that because that gets me a little sad. Continue on with the preamble of the Earth Charter, the finish. Towards this end, it is imperative that we, the peoples of Earth, declare our responsibility to one another, to the greater community of life, and to future generations. I have several nieces and one nephew. I've been a teacher for more than 10 years now, and I can consider the things that I do, I need to leave a legacy. I do not know when my time is up. Who does know? But if or when my time comes, I want to be sure that something is left behind positive for them. Fairgoer 1651 has a question. How long did it take you to research information on the issue or issues and put them into writing? This particular book, The Global Situation, took approximately 3 years of work. The version that is currently available is actually the third revision of this book. There are several all-nighters that I did to make sure that this book was right, and research I needed to do, and find the right pictures and purchase the right pictures on a ship so that I have the rights to them, at least in the book. If they're out there, cyberspace, or just for real, it doesn't really belong to me. Just the pictures that I purchased for this book, I have ownership rights to them. That's one of the key things for writing. If you do get pictures for your book, unless it's exactly just some individuals you took pictures of, may be best for you to purchase the images through whatever service. Fairy Girl Goer 1651 says, wow, I can't imagine 3 years to take. 3 years, so yes, the first try was 1 year. And I didn't really like what I did so much, so I wanted to fix it up. I made a second version with a prior publisher, which did not do so well for me. And then I found, well, Reader's Magnet basically found me. One of the agents had called me several years ago, and we began talking a lot throughout the books and about each of my books. And I had to come to decision. The first interest book of Reader's Magnet was my first book, Knowledge for Tomorrow. Somehow, someone in this company got a hold of it or knew about it. And I decided to talk more about my children's book and then this global situation. And I worked on both of those two books at the same time with the agent. And sadly, she left the agency for her own pursuits. And thank you, Rain. That's what I'm talking about. Helped get me started into this company. I definitely feel like I'm a part of it. Had a lot of basically all-nighters. I spent two, sometimes three nights in a row on one or both books, and slept when I could. When I'm on a roll. It's my creativity and desire to find out and verify information, find the right images, so on, was all going on full speed in there. I did get a little burnout a couple times, a writer's block. That does happen in the process. But got a lot of information down. And as I said, this particular book is about a little over 300 pages. Revisions, constantly I've got information about pandemics. There's more than one pandemic that humans have gone through. And I've listed each one and some details of each. Coronavirus, one we currently are going through. That's mentioned in this book. There's several flus and some research on potentials of other pandemics. I have that added in this book as well. There are, I guess on page 94, I think is where I placed it. There's about two other pandemics that seem to be coming. Okay, question from Fairgoer 1648. During those 3 years in the making, did you think about not continuing with writing the book? During my issue with writer's block, when I had to stop, I was kind of burned out a bit. Yes, I had to say yes on that. But something always came up to bring me back. An environmental issue that was put onto CNN, which I decided to do some more research on, and bounced me back into the book. Just straight basic concern, seeing other things going on nearby me. I live nearby one of the largest watershed areas on the western coast of the United States. The Sassoon Marsh is basically a few miles away, kilometers away, and how you think about the math. So I see there's a very large, it's a migration pattern, location, stopover for many birds and other, some types of insects, butterflies, so forth, come straight through this area. And that's some concern about some of those life forms, making sure that they're safe, they have safe passage, stopover to get their needed sustenance before they take the next step of their journey, whichever way they're going, north or south, Canada or down to Mexico, or just staying here. There are blackbirds, red-winged blackbirds, sometimes the butterflies and so on, life that live or come through this direction. Okay, now I've covered a lot of different issues. I did mention a while back about the oxygen level of the planet that it is dropping. We are humans, our activities, we've been killing many of the major forests of this planet, rainforests, all around the world. And plants produce oxygen, and we need oxygen to breathe, to respirate, do our natural involuntary functions as life forms. Essentially, humans are somewhat committing suicide, both to our own species and involuntary murder. This is the better term, of many, many other life forms. And our basic biosphere is in danger. The biosphere is the living area of the Earth, surface, and also in the oceans. The oxygen levels can be found in my book. I have on page 15. Put a lot of information in the first two chapters for actions that can be committed by anyone and everyone. It's an organization which I'm now a part of called the Climate Protectors. You can go, the website is climateprotectors.net. Climate Protectors, building to be a major organization. It's a portion of the Sierra Club, which I'm also an officer within. The Sierra Club, Greenpeace, World Wildlife Fund, several. It is still morning here. Several different organizations are still open and available for you to join and help. Those are probably the best way that you can help our world, is to join an organization, right, which is, its principles are to do so. Even PETA is one, is on, along the rankings of that. I have some evidence of current effects of climate change. In 88, in the summer in the U.S., a severe drought and heat wave killed an estimated 8,000 to 10,000 people, including heat stress related deaths in the year 2000. spring and summer, worldwide severe drought and heat killed an estimated 20,000 people. It is much more than if that's occurred. I didn't want to go through too many details. I want to get straight to the point out of this. In 2002, in March, the breakup of the Larsen ice shelf, one of the largest ice shelves in Antarctica, happened. And that ice shelf by now has melted into our oceans. And ocean sea level has risen. I'll tell you how much in a moment, and I'm sure you can find out yourselves as well. May and June 2003, a month-long intense heat wave claimed more than 53,000 lives worldwide. 2006, July 16th to the 25th, in California alone, my state, a two-week heat wave killed at least 160 people in one city alone. And that didn't count the entire state for this research, but it's that one location, which I believe was San Francisco. I may be wrong on that one. I'm sorry I didn't put that in the book, but you know, it can be found. 2007, August, up to 500 people were estimated to have died across the country of Hungary due to a heat wave. 2009, the U.S. had 291,237 record heat waves. That's a lot of locations. 2010, 113 degrees in Los Angeles, California, in September 28th. And 2010, 129 degrees in Pakistan on June 1st. Summer had just begun, 129 degrees in one day. And one of the most scary things that I found out in research just last year, before, and this is a part of Revision 3. In June 2020, well inside the Arctic Circle, on the Asian side of it, there's a heat wave that hit a temperature of 100.4 degrees Fahrenheit in the Arctic. Now, I'm sure many of you are aware that the Arctic is melting. 2020, July through September, Siberia and major wildfires, Russia. I'll stop there on the wildfires because there's so many around the world that I have listed. Now, moving further ahead, I think it's just about time. And I begin to end my presentation with you. Let's see here. I will give you the final video information in my book. Okay.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind. Yeah. Amazing grace has...
All right. Okay. We didn't go over time too much. Let's see, my book, The Global Situation. There's a lot for you. And it's not just including information, it's including organizations that you can join or somehow help. In other ways that you can help if you cannot deploy in much time on your behalf. Leave a legacy. Let's remember we're all mortal, and all the life on this world is as well. It is our job to help to stop the damage. Okay.